NASCAR action on Speed from Kansas Speedway rolls on this busy Friday afternoon. Time now for NASCAR Busch Series qualifying to set the entire starting grid for tomorrow's United Way 300. A busy qualifying session it will be. 54 cars are here at Kansas Speedway to try and make the 43-car starting grid. As the series winds down, the chase for the NASCAR Busch Series Championship, well, it's heating up. Over the last four races, Martin Truex's lead over Clint Bowyer has gone from over 200 points down to just 26. And they'll go head-to-head tomorrow here on this mile-and-a-half track in Bowyer's home state, with Bowyer trying to perhaps take that championship lead away at the end of 300 miles. And welcome to our coverage of Busch Pole qualifying. Alan Bestwick here with Jeff Hammond and Larry McReynolds. 54 cars, 43 spots, a lot of drivers under a lot of pressure for a couple of quick laps here.
A lot of people here today are going to be looking at what I consider the Bushwhackers are here also. You take a look around in this field, all of a sudden you got 16 guys that are doing double duty this weekend, and a lot of these guys are doing also involved in the chase for the championship. Mark Martin, Rusty Wallace are all running the Busch race here this weekend, looking to get that little extra seat time and trying to gain on this racetrack, which I think is very important for their efforts as far as the chase for the championship, guys.
Let's talk about weather. It's a pretty chilly day here at Kansas today, Larry. Weather and speeds. Might we see a track record in qualifying here?
The weather is perfect for a track record. Trust me, yeah. Yeah, the sun is out. There's not a cloud in the sky, but we're in temperatures in the 40 and 50 degree range right now, and that horsepower loves that. The track has a lot of grip, so I would say possibly that track record could be in jeopardy here shortly.
And it might be a Martin who makes that track record happen today. Mark Martin or Martin Truex, fastest in today's earlier practice sessions. And we'll find out when they hit the track just moments from now. It's NASCAR Busch Pole qualifying from the Kansas Speedway, live on Speed, and the first car rolls when we come back after this. Eastern time tonight on Speed. It is trackside from here at Kansas Speedway. Who we got tonight? Did I hear Junior?
Yep, Dale Junior and the Cat in the Hat will be there. Jack Roush.
He's got probably a little bit to talk about, you think?
Not him.
Won't have any shocking answers, will he?
Never does.
That's quite a combination, though. Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Jack Roush.
Yes, sir. 7 o'clock tonight from Kansas Eastern time here at Speed. We go to pit road and Dave Burns.
And banana peels, but that's a whole nother story. Matt Kenseth goes out ninth today. Matt, how good is your Busch car?
I think it's okay. I don't think we got a very good draw for today. You know, it's October, and it's going to get pretty cold here in about an hour. But I think we're all right. We seem to have a lot of speed in our car. I think it'll qualify well. I'm not sure about racing. I think our race package maybe wasn't quite as good.
All right, all these Nextel Cup guys making the long walk from the Cup Garage up to the Busch Series qualifying grid, Alan.
What's the banana peels thing about, Dave?
I just can't speak to it. It's an inside joke among drivers, and somehow Matt ended up with a banana peel moments ago.
Okay. I don't quite understand that, but he talked about walking down through. I noticed that Ellie Sadler, who's going out second, jogging down pit road to get down to his car, which is in line to qualify, as we watch Kevin Harvick in the 21 car going out to make his qualifying effort.
Actually, Kevin was slated to go out 26th, but NASCAR has allowed him to go out first here because Kevin will be leaving Kansas, headed back to North Carolina to be with his wife, Delana, whose dad is in very, very bad shape. So certainly our well wishes and prayers go out to the Linville family.
Yeah, John Paul Linville, about 62 years old, ran about 137 Busch races back in his day, and he was a pretty fierce competitor, too.
Last time Kevin Harvick ran a NASCAR Busch Series race, he wound up in victory lane. That was at Richmond a couple of weeks back. Dominated that one. And he is on the clock now here at Kansas. Ooh, little wiggle, little wobble.
Ooh, hang on there, brother.
He's got his hands full with this qualifying run. It was not real pretty in the beginning of this run.
He was checking right there to see if he thought he might have had a flat tire where he's moving the car around.
Well, that was his second lap. The first lap was in at 30.596.
That's a little bit quicker than he had ran earlier, the 30.59. I have him in that first practice at a 30.65.
Kind of blasted off there into one and two to get some more on that second lap, and didn't work out.
And the thing is, right now, Alan, we've been up here doing the Nextel Cup practice session a minute ago. We've seen that a lot of times. If you miss the groove, and several of the drivers, Carl Edwards in particular, said this is a one-groove racetrack at this time. So if you go in and drive in a little bit hard and all of a sudden slide up just a least little bit, the car is going to take off and go to the wall. So I'm not surprised to see that, and I'll be even bigger surprised if we don't see more before the end of this qualifying session.
And just to put a period on the 21 car, Jeff Burton also practiced that car earlier, and it's anticipated that if Kevin does not make it back tomorrow, he's going to do his best to be back for the next Nextel Cup race on Sunday, that Jeff Burton will run that 21 car in the Busch Series 300 miler tomorrow.
What you're seeing here, you saw here on Speed, Nextel Cup practice just ended. As fate would have it, all the guys that drew the numbers at the front of the Busch Series qualifying line are Nextel Cup drivers just making their way down to the head end and starting to buckle in. You caught a picture of Elliott Sadler there. Denny Hamlin's in front of him, running the 11 for Joe Gibbs on the Cup side this weekend. He's just getting buckled in. Mike Wallace was ready to go, so we've sent him out on the track.
But he's running the Nextel Cup race as well. He was in that practice in the four car earlier. A new crew chief of this race team, Jer Cannon, who been around Busch Racing for years, is the new crew chief. Casey Kane will be in this car at Lowe's. Interesting, A.J. Foyt IV will run this car at Memphis. They went over and tested with him last week.
And Larry, he has been, I guess you might say, lurking around the garage area quite a bit here lately. That's A.J. Foyt IV, that is, trying to get into a stock car with who his grandfather is, A.J. Foyt.
He's got a little fender up going here, Mike Wallace does. I noticed that on the one plate. Is it the right rear, it almost looks like?
I think it's coming off the left front right there, Alan. As he gets down in the corners right there, you see it rubbing just a little bit, and it's leaking out the back of the car.
But that's not unusual to see a left front rubbing, especially qualifying, because remember, they put a lot of tape on the nose of these cars. It plants the nose. The car travels more because this is an impound race as it is for every Busch event.
See that there, Kyle, off the corner?
I think that right there.
I think he's got a little rub on the right rear.
Right rear also.
Yeah. First lap of Mike was 31.138. So about 6-tenths of a second, about 5-tenths of a second off of what Kevin Harvick did on his one lap on the clock.
Yeah, that's slower than what Mike ran in practice earlier. In the final practice, he was 36 quickest at a 30.91, so he has slowed down a couple of tenths.
So, Mike, this the, let's see, 6th different Busch Series car he's driven this year is this 38 team, but he'll give it a go tomorrow. Right now, second fastest. Bob Dillner is down on pit road for us. Bob?
Alan, Greg Biffle, one of those guys that jogged down here to get from the Cup garage to one of their up front qualifying spots here on the grid. He was 34th quick this morning. Greg, that's pretty surprising. We expect you to be up a little bit higher. How about it here in qualifying?
Yeah, we didn't make a qualifying run with the subway car here, so I think we're going to be pretty decent. But let's see what happens. We worked on race trim a lot, and I think we're going to be, hopefully we'll qualify top 15 here.
These guys got a little bit of exercise, Alan, running their way down pit road, as evident by Elliott Sadler and Greg Biffle and even Rusty Wallace.
It's good for them.
It's good for them. Yes, absolutely.
I just realized when I looked at the sheet, Alan, which you pointed out already, but the first seven guys are all doing the double duty this weekend.
Yeah.
So a lot of these guys, like you say, just coming off the racetrack. Michael Waltrip, one of those drivers who had a little altercation in his number 15 at the Chevrolet last time he was on the racetrack. So let's see what Michael can do as far as bouncing back from that problem early on in practice.
Now, Alan, you talked about speeds. This is the current track record holder here. He set the track record back in 2003 at a 30.27. We anticipate, based on what we saw in practice, that that track record will go down today.
Michael, one of the go-or-go-home cars in the NASCAR Busch Series, was only 32nd fastest in practice and 10th quickest among those go-or-go-home cars.
And right now, he's close to half a second off what he ran in practice earlier today, lap 1:31.31. Most of the crew chiefs were telling me this morning they felt like a lot due to, I think, heat in the tires, that you could run quicker, for the most part, on your second lap.
Well, Michael needs to find some of that speed on that second lap, Larry McReynolds, if he wants to make it into this race.
He's got his hands full, Alan, there's no doubt.
You can see the hands kind of going through that windshield coming off of Ford. He was working it hard.
Actually slows down on that second lap, so I don't think he's going to be very happy with that lap.
No, because he's actually missed a couple of Busch races this year, being a go-or-go-home car.
Yep, they're working hard to try and get this program turned around, but it takes time. And right now, Michael, third out of three that have gone so far. at 31.31 his time, 172.4 miles an hour. And Elliott Sadler, another go or go home car, out on track now. Elliott, eighth fastest among the 24 go or go homes in practice earlier today.
You know, the one thing, though, Alan, you mentioned about all these first cars going out being Nextel Cup guys is practice just ended. And at least these guys know somewhat what the racetrack has in it, if it's lost grip since the Busch cars last had practice.
Well, I guess the question is, they know what to expect from the track conditions, but this Busch Series car was last on the track, what, 4 hours ago?
But at least they are able to go back to the crew chief on the Busch Series car and say, look, the racetrack has tightened up. Take me a half a pound of air out of the right front. You know, they can make air pressure adjustments even though the cars, he ran out of racetrack there in a hurry off turn two, but they can make adjustments to air pressure and things based on how their cup car felt to him. And Elliott Sadler was the fastest in Nextel Cup practice.
But Larry, as we said a minute ago, these guys, unless these crew chiefs on these Busch Series cars were listening, all these drivers have just literally ran up to their cars, so they hadn't had a lot of time to make a lot of adjustments.
New leader.
And considering what it looked like off turn two, that's a pretty good lap.
Yep. 30.576 beat Kevin Harvick by 0.02 of a second, and I think he just got the word.
No, I think he just got tired of holding his breath, Alan.
But that pretty much mirrored what he ran in practice. No quicker, no slower.
57, that's P1 so far.
That was the word just getting to Elliott Sadler. Bob?
Well, if you wonder why the yellow car is blue this week, let me explain why. United Way on the hood for Johnny Sauter. And this is something that he has been very involved with this entire week. Johnny Sauter strapping behind the wheel of his car right now. So, Johnny, what's up with the United Way, and what have you been doing all week here in Kansas?
Everybody knows that, and if they don't know, that Yellow Transportation's home base here is in Kansas City. So I actually got here Monday, been doing a lot of things, a lot of cool things, but pretty cool deal. Yellow Transportation and people at Sprint actually purchased the rights to the race and actually gave it to the United Way. So it's the first time that the charitable organization's headlined a NASCAR event. So history kind of being made here tomorrow, I guess. But been pretty cool. Got a lot of people from Yellow here this week, and hopefully we got a good car for them.
Johnny's been pretty busy as well. In fact, they had an eBay auction, and the winners of that eBay auction were going to get their name on the rear deck lid of this car. Well, guess who won the auction, guys? Johnny Sauter. So he's actually putting the American Red Cross, among other charities, on the rear deck lid tomorrow just to benefit those charities.
Very nice. Thank you, Bob. Here is Denny Hamlin.
And Denny will be making his Nextel Cup debut here this weekend, driving the 11 FedEx car. Was pretty good in both those practice sessions earlier today.
Yep.
On his first lap, he's third quickest at a 30.90.
Denny was not very good in the second practice, but in the first practice for the Busch Series this morning, was 23rd fastest at a 30.81.
Yeah, he was 42nd quickest in that last practice at a 31.05, so he has picked it up from that by about a tenth and a half, puts him third quickest right now. And he's one of the cars that has now picked up a little bit on that second lap. Yep.
30.83 for Denny Hamlin, puts him third out of five so far. Talk about 12 months making a difference, right? Here's a kid made his first Busch Series start last November at Homestead, and now he's going to make his first Nextel Cup start here this weekend.
No pressure.
Provided qualifying goes well tomorrow.
No pressure.
Dave is with Elliott Sadler.
Elliott Sadler getting quick refreshment after that very fast qualifying run. Is that going to stick?
No, I don't think they'll be on the pole, but I think they'll be in the top 10. I just made a run of my cup call, so I'd probably didn't give the City of Financial Ford a fair shake. But they'll be in the top 10, but we got a really good call for the race. That's all I care about, really. We should be fine tomorrow. It was really good on long runs, and I'm happy with the guys. They did a good job preparing the car this weekend, so I'm looking forward to tomorrow.
Were you saying you just made a mock qualifying run in your cup car? So yeah. You've been holding your breath quite a bit here lately.
Well, I just made a run in my cup car, then I had to run the whole length of pit road to get in my car to beat the 5 minute clock, and I am way too fat to be running on my feet. That's why I have a sit down job. So I'm a little tired now.
Considering all that, Alan, that's a pretty darn good lap.
He's had a hard afternoon. Here's the Biff. By the way, it was Darlington last fall that Denny Hamlin made his debut.
Okay.
My bad.
Close enough. You said the fall.
I get three strikes, don't I? Yeah, exactly. Versus the spring in July. Well, we won't go there.
Guys, on his first lap, Greg Biffle was third quickest, and if he can pick up just a little bit like Denny Hamlin did, he could slip up in front of Elliott Sadler.
Now, Jeff, you and I talked to Greg last night. Interesting. We've been talking about the points battle in the Busch Series. Right now, Greg Biffle, now remember, he's only ran 22 of the 29 races. He's 11th in the points, 27 points out of 10th. I said, Greg, tell me you're going to go run Memphis. He said, no, I'm going to keep my focus on that 16 car. And he's right now got his focus on sitting on the pole because he is the fastest car. But he will skip Memphis. But I still think the man can finish in the top 10 in points.
He might.
Yeah, he got kind of close to Michael Waltrip's track record, only about a tenth off of that, but he found about 3/10 in that second lap.
You can pencil Biffle in as one of the favorites for tomorrow's race. He's never finished worse than fourth here in four tries in a Busch Series car. Nice lap, 30.377, and there's your new qualifying leader, Greg Biffle. Russell William Wallace says he's going to run the rest of the races that this team that he owns is scheduled to run this year because he wants to get it squared away for next year. The rest of the races save for one.
Memphis.
That's right.
Young Stephen Wallace will be in that car, and I hear they had an excellent test over there last week. Rusty's son.
Yeah, I got a chance to talk to Rusty about that, and he was very, very pleased with the effort they put out. And early on this morning, he said this car was really driving well, had a little miss on in it, and they were changing carburetors. So let's see what Rusty can do on his first lap of qualifying. Just like a lot of these other drivers, he's already been on this racetrack making a making a practice run in his cup car, so he knows what to expect as far as the track conditions are concerned.
Rusty Wallace was 27th fastest in practice.
Had a good run at Dover a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah.
Driving this for this race team.
Yep, started 11th, finished 7th. Still with an interim crew chief situation. Hasn't hired someone to be the permanent guy yet for 2006. First lap for Rusty, going to be 5th fastest.
Not going to be very happy with that unless he can make a pickup like Greg Biffle. That was a 31-12, and he ran a 30-74 in practice earlier.
You're talking about that test session over at Memphis with Rusty and Steven. Said they kind of alternated in the car. Rusty would run some. Steven would get in and run some. Rusty would run some. Steven would run some. And they really were pleased at the way it came out. Look forward to seeing how Steven makes out in his first Busch Series try here in a few weeks.
I say it would be interesting. Now, Rusty, he picks it up on that second lap, but right now he's only 5th quickest out of the 7 cars that have qualified.
Bob Dillner is with Casey Kane, I believe.
Yeah, and it's pretty chilly down here, uncommon for this time of the year at Kansas. In fact, last year we were sweating here, Casey Kane. You can see he's got the ski cap on here. What has the cold weather done to the track and done for qualifying here in the Busch here?
It's given it a lot of grip. Ever since this morning, we've had a couple practices in the regular Dodge Charger, and it was fast in practice this morning. The Dodge dealer's car, UAW Dodge car over there on the cup side is really good too. So I don't know what's going to happen. I think we should have some good qualifying efforts, and then depending on what the weather does the rest of the weekend can make a big change.
Dave, it's pretty chilly down here. A lot of guys with their eyes on the sky and what Mother Nature is doing here.
Greg Biffle with his eyes on the pole position, perhaps just had a little breakdown there with his crew chief, Newt Moore. How was that lap, and is it going to hold?
You know, it's going to be tough to beat. That was a pretty good lap for the Subway car, and we're just excited to have Subway and Red Cross in the car. October 23rd, they're going to give 5% of all the money they make to the Red Cross Disaster Relief Fund, and that's exciting. Subway's involved in our racing like that, and just happy to have it on the pole here at Kansas. Hope the Cup car's close to being that good. That was almost flat. It's closer you get to going flat foot across the corner here at Kansas.
If I heard correctly, October 23rd is the date I need to go eat at Subway. Is that right?
Absolutely. October 23rd, everybody go out and get a sub sandwich at a Subway, and you know, it's 5% of all the all their money goes to Red Cross.
Thanks, Greg. Good luck. We'll see if that lap holds for a while, guys.
Dave, you got to be careful how you say things sometimes. When you say breakdown and Newt Moore close together, we get concerned.
I'll separate them by at least a few sentences next time, Alan.
Thank you.
Tell you what, this little 11 car, Paul Menard, they just continue this role they're on. He's second quickest now. He picks it up a couple of tenths. And sitting quietly 7th in the points, but top 10 finishes in 12 of his last 14 races. Making a little noise here.
It's kind of like the light came on in the middle of the summer for both he and the team. It just all kind of fell together, and they've been great.
Yeah, I had a chance to talk to some of the crew members and the crew chief up in Dover just a couple weeks ago about that same situation, and that's exactly what they said. He said all of a sudden he just kind of found his zone, and he really has just become all of a sudden a force to be reckoned with week in and week out, not only qualifying but also during the race.
Hey, guys, Paul was the first non-Nextel Cup regular to go out and qualify.
He is second fastest now.
Denny Hamlin's running a Nextel Cup race there. I guess Paul's the first one to go out that wasn't in Nextel Cup practice just a little while ago.
I was deciding whether I wanted to roll you under the bus there or not.
It's kind of like your November in the spring.
Yeah, thank you. That's why I didn't do it. Bob Dildar, what do you got?
Hey, boys, Joe Nemechek, the sweepster here last year, winning both the Busch Series race and the Cup Series race. But how about Busch qualifying? You going to be front row Joe again here?
I think I've got a shot. We made one attempt of it at it there in practice. And my cellular one Chevy's been driving really good. I got to thank Gary Putnam, all my crew guys, just working so hard. It's a car we ran earlier in the year, and we tuned it back up, and it's been running pretty good. It's got a good feel to it, so feels better than the car I had here last year.
You didn't answer my question, though. You going to put it on the front row?
I'm going to try. I'm going to definitely try. You know, we practiced this morning. It was really cool. Track temperature's way up from what it was this morning. So as we've seen in cup practice, seems like you slide around a little bit more. I'm going to do my best.
When we got here, boys, air temperature in the high 30s this morning right now, hovering about 50.
Jorge Getters looking for his second oval track start in the NASCAR Busch Series and his eighth out of nine so far.
Yeah, he struggled in practice earlier today, 52nd quickest, but this was our Busch pole sitter from the road race in Mexico back in the spring.
Yep.
But it looks to me like, Larry, like each time he goes out, he's getting a little quicker, and that's what you expect from a guy that's shown to have the talent that Jorge has.
Did a very respectable job at Pikes Peak in his first oval track race in one of these cars. Very respectable. Well, let's see if... we'll have a new fast lap after this lap. Matt Kenseth, very quick in practice earlier today.
We talked about this a little bit earlier, but Matt has, for some reason, found that he can go fast when it comes to qualifying, both in the Busch ranks as well as the Nextel Cup, and he was second quickest today in the last practice.
Yeah, that time was a 30-20, so that would definitely be about a tenth and a half better than Greg Biffle's time if he can just get back to where he practiced earlier.
Let's see what it is. 30.377, time to beat for Matt Kenseth. And he will not beat it on the first lap. It'll be a 30.65. Needs a little bit.
Yeah, he's going to need to pick up about 3/10 to knock Greg Biffle. I'm not sure he can get back to what he ran in practice, though, at that 30.20. Just have to see. And I think just a lot of this is a product of being able to run a little quicker on your second lap, getting the heat in the tires. You heard Bob Dillner talk about how cool it is. These tires don't want to grip when they're that cold.
Using it all. Close. Not close enough.
Second quickest for Matt.
30.529 for Matt Kenseth is going to leave about a tenth and a half on the table shy of Greg Biffle. 10 of 54 cars have run in Busch Pole qualifying from Kansas Speedway. Back with more live coverage in just a minute. Tomorrow morning on Speed, Bud Pole qualifying live from Kansas at 11:30 Eastern time. The race for the NASCAR Nextel Cup continuing here. Tony Stewart leading the championship. We'll see how he and the others qualify for Sunday's 400-miler. 11:30 Eastern tomorrow morning, Bud Pole qualifying on Speed.
How about this, boys? New track record for Regan Smith in his 58 car. Not surprising, though, Jeff, he was fifth quickest in practice.
Now, this young man here and this race team, they seem like they get better and better every week. This past week, they've been testing Memphis and a couple other places trying to get the handle on this car, and they look like they found it, my friend. They've got this car really hooked up, and he's been doing an awesome job here recently.
Yeah, again, they're finally getting some brand-new race cars. He slows down a little bit on lap two. They tested here. They tested at Memphis. It just seems like, and you know, when I talked to the team, they talked about going and testing all those days in one week. He said the biggest thing it accomplished, it gelled the team together because we were with each other so long.
And, you know, Regan, he's a young guy. Just, 22 years old, just getting kind of like Paul Menard. The light came on.
The light has definitely come on with this team right here. And, again, when I talked to him down in the garage area, you know, he was so excited about what has been accomplished here recently, especially in the last couple of weeks. He's been showing a lot of muscle. He really has.
Speaking of lights on, I think the light's on Dave Burns' camera.
And we will point it at Paul Menard. Last year's pole sitter, Paul, you probably came in with hopes of repeating that, but did you ever really have a shot at it from the start? How good's your car?
Car was pretty good qualifying, actually. Touch free right through the center. We worked all practice on race runs, did one qualifying run at the very end, so we didn't put a whole lot of emphasis on it. Last year we had to work on it. We had to race our way in, so I'm real happy. I mean, we unloaded this morning, and the car wasn't all that great, but Dan and the boys really worked their tails off and got the car pretty good. So we got Splash on the hoods this week, and we always have good finishes when we do, so hopefully we can pull one off.
Stepped it up, currently fourth on the board. To Bob Dillner.
Dave walking along with his teammate Martin Truex Jr., and he does have a shot at the pole here today. You were fastest in the final practice session, but I know the thing that you're more concerned about, beating that two car come Saturday.
Well, you know, we're going to try. We try every week, and some things have happened lately. They've been out of our control, or just had some bad luck and stuff. So we've been running good. Bass Pro Shave was real good this morning in race runs and real good in qualifying. I hope it's not too loose to go real fast. It was pretty good earlier, so we'll see. Trying to stay warm, and hopefully we put down a good lap this afternoon.
We'll see what Martin Truex Jr. does here during qualifying, but Larry Mack, in the last four races, the two car has beat the number eight car in the battle for the championship.
And we certainly don't mean to count Reed Sorensen or Carl Edwards or anyone else out of this championship battle, but you do get a feeling with six races to go, It's all but down to a two-man battle between Martin Truex Jr. and Clint Bowyer.
And four races ago, you thought it was over.
They were already engraving the trophy. Yeah. They unplugged it real quick.
11th of 12 for Mark Green so far. And Dave, nice lap for Regan Smith.
He was fast in practice. He was very fast in qualifying run. How much did you have to hold your breath on that lap?
Actually, I didn't have to hold it too much. The cars, man, we've been good since we unloaded. I've been really proud of all these Sampson Stone guys. They built this car in a matter of about a week, and they did a good job at the shop getting ready and came out here and tested. We tested really well and just pumped up to come out here and race. And I don't know if that'll hold up for pole, but it should be pretty good, so we'll take it and see what happens in the race. Been working real hard on our race program, so excited.
You guys did well. We're running well at Dover as well. I mean, you got to be pretty excited about where this program's going.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it seems like these past few weeks we've really been stepping it up, and you know, we found a lot of stuff. We've been learning a lot and just working hard to get better each week, and see where it takes us here next couple weeks.
Regan Smith, guys.
Hear the excitement in his voice, a little quiver there while he was that was great.
Well, yeah, he's making a statement right now, I think, yeah. Alan. He's letting everybody out there and in that garage area and who's ever watching on television, let them know that I'm for real. I can drive a race car. So it just gives me an opportunity. If I can stick with these guys, we'll get a better sponsor, we can go faster.
And it appears Scott Glenn, the owner of that car, I know that's another thing the guy said as we watched Johnny Sauter start his qualifying run, that Scott Glenn has given them everything they need to be competitive.
Nice first lap for Sauter.
If he can find a couple of tenths, he can move on up this a little bit more, maybe challenge for the pole.
Yeah, he was 10th quickest in practice earlier to 30-37. He's not quite there on that first lap. Maybe he can pick it up on the second lap like we've seen a few cars do.
Well, those hands weren't moving at all when he came
pretty
off
solid,
turn four,
pretty solid.
Man with a hometown sponsor, Yellow Transportation, based here in Kansas City. Second lap for Johnny, a little bit faster. Not enough to move him up any positions, though. 30.451, and it'll leave him third out of 13 that have gone. Still pretty early in the going in Busch Pole qualifying from the Kansas Speedway. You're watching NASCAR on Speed. Thursday night, 6:30 Eastern on Speed. New show for the chase for the Nextel Cup called The Chase is On. Dale Jarrett joins Ralph Shaheen. They break down the facts, stats, and everything else going on in the chase for the Nextel Cup. Thursday night, 6:30 Eastern on Speed.
And this business is definitely picking up as far as the chase is concerned.
Don't you love it?
Oh, I do.
I mean, you know, I grew up a hockey fan as we watched Justin Labonte qualify. Best time of the year was Stanley Cup playoff time. Best time of the year in baseball is World Series time. Best time of the year, once you get past the Daytona 500 now, in NASCAR, is playoff time.
But the great thing about our playoff, all 43 are still out there playing.
Yep.
And the good thing about it, it doesn't seem to matter what division and what type of format we're talking about, whether it's Craftsman Truck, or Busch Series, or Nextel Cup. All three of these series are having a great point battle.
Yep. Very nice for Justin Labonte.
Good pickup on that second lap, and that's a good pickup from what he ran in practice. And right now, he'll be eighth quickest.
Out of 14 that have gone so far. Bob, is that Uncle Bobby you're with?
That's right, Uncle Bobby, watching his nephew, Justin, just go around the racetrack. You going to be faster than your nephew or what?
I hope so. Gosh, I got to be careful how I say that, but yeah, I hope so, yeah. So anyway, our banquet car is pretty good. Banquet Chevrolet is good, and we're eighth fastest this morning in practice, so we'll see what we got. You know, we haven't been on the racetrack for a while with this car, so made a couple adjustments thinking that the weather we might need to adjust for it, and see what we got.
Bobby, some of the young kids say they hold their breath going around this racetrack and qualifying trim. How about the veteran? You.
You got to hold your breath, you know, but if your car works pretty good, you don't have to hold it very long.
Bobby Labonte, eighth quick this morning, boys.
Good theory.
Very good theory. What's so interesting when you ask Bobby a question like what Bob did about Justin, the reason why they don't want to make a comment, him or his daddy, Terry, is because a lot of times Justin will show these guys up. He's pretty quick a lot of times.
And of course, if you make the boast, then you have to go deal with it.
You got to back it up.
Sure.
Exactly right.
But I think what Bobby Labonte said supports what Regan Smith said. Your car drives good. I didn't have to hold my breath. Everything was good.
Tim Sauter on the clock now. First lap. Gunnarine Bohr, 31.462. That's the slowest of the 15 that have run so far.
That's a half a second slower than he ran in practice earlier, which seems to be the norm. There's not a lot of cars that's able to run quicker than they ran in practice earlier. But he's definitely going to have to pick it up if he wants to race tomorrow.
Tim, one of the go-or-go-home cars.
I noticed a lot of cars on that second lap. I've seen them pushing water out the overflow on the right-hand side of the windshield. A lot of cars spitting water out, running a little bit hot on that second lap.
Well, he picks it up, but I don't know if that's going to be enough to get him in this show. 31-41.
And that is 15th out of 15 so far for Tim Sauter. Not too good.
I think we need to mention one more time, we still have like 53 qualifiers here today. So we've got a lot of cars and a long way to go.
To make the race with the top 30, pretty much guaranteed, to make the race with the other 24 cars, you've got to be 13, right? You've got to be one of the 13 fastest, I'm sorry.
And then we have two past champions that are trying to make the show, Steve Grissom, as well as, we talked to him a while ago, Bobby Labonte.
Yep. Here's Casey Kane. 17th fastest in practice, sorry.
He's always been pretty solid here qualifying in the Busch car. In fact, he's sat on the outside pole for the last two races and sat on the outside pole for last year's Nextel Cup race. So he knows how to get around here and qualify.
See if he can find the speed in this car today to keep that pace up.
From that shot, looking inside the car, he looked very calm and looked like he's very smooth through the middle of the turn. So third quickest on that first lap. So yes, all he needs to find just another tenth and he have an opportunity to bump Regan Smith off the pole.
And he has definitely picked up from what he ran in practice earlier because it was a 30-51, so he's better than a tenth. This is the car that ran so well at Fontana back about a month ago for Casey. Qualified second, finished fifth there.
Of course, this car is owned by Ray Evernham. It's second quickest on that second lap.
What'd you say about twos?
He picked it up, 30-28, outside pole right now.
Yeah. Perhaps the streak will continue for a third straight year, though we've got a long way to go. Casey Kane, second fastest behind Regan Smith and ahead of Greg Biffle. There's Ray Evernham. He should be pretty pleased with that effort. You can take control of America's fastest sport with Speed NASCAR TV On Demand, including NASCAR Race Rewinds, NASCAR Victory Lane, and NASCAR Beyond the Wheel. It's updated every week, and it's totally free. Check with your local cable provider, Speed NASCAR TV On Demand, now.
And wait a minute. Free?
It's what it says right here. Not just free, it says it's totally free.
And if it's free, it's for me.
There you go, like most of us. Kevin LePage here for Randy McDonald Motorsports. They've got a new sponsor here on their car this week. One off deal.
Right now, Kevin is the slowest of the cars have gone on the 17th in his first lap, so he's going to be looking to pick it up here on his second.
That's about what he ran in practice, so it's not like so far that he's really slowed down in this 72 car.
Seven go or go home drivers have run so far, and that is going to put Kevin at the bottom of that list.
Picks it up, just does not pick up a position.
Well, the time to beat is a 30-20. Bobby, does Mark Martin think he can do it?
Well, he doesn't know just yet. He's going out on the racetrack just shortly here. But Mark Martin, what about it? Is this car capable of getting the pole here today?
No, not the way it's set up. We're set up for the race, and we're set up good for the race. You're nowhere near running that kind of lap time. We got to put it in the race. We've got a car that can contend to win, and that's what we came to do with Penske Ford. So we'll take what we can get here.
We always know that Mark Martin's always a contender. Two wins already on the Busch Series this year, Dave.
With Casey Kane now, let's pick up about 0.3 on that lap, Casey. But you came in car running. Could it have gone a little bit more on the tape side? Was it, you know, not overheating yet?
No, we were actually a little too hot. In the second lap, I felt like I lost a little bit of power that we definitely needed. Regan Smith ran a great lap. We qualified second here last year in a great Clips car. And, you know, hopefully second today in the right good car. I don't know. There's still some good cars. So we'll see. Definitely top 10 and have a good starting spot tomorrow. I think our car is definitely better in race trim than what it was in qualifying trim today.
And, of course, they've already seen race trim. These cars impounded following qualifying, guys.
All right, Dave, thanks. Here's front row Joe. Not front row on his first lap. Going to be 10th fastest out of 18 so far.
Yeah, he has slowed down 0.4. You could almost, instead of calling him front row Joe based on last year, you could call him Joe Kansas because he sat on the pole for the Nextel Cup race and won both the Busch Series and Nextel Cup race a year ago.
Can't you do a little bit better than that? Joe Kansas. I think it sounds better for
Kansas Joe. Okay. That definitely sounds a little better.
I'll tell you what, it was a dream weekend.
It really was. I think even more so because he had his son Hunter with him out there and being able to jump up and down and cheer his dad on.
I don't know about jumping up and down, but he definitely jumped up on that second lap. He goes to fifth quickest.
30-45 and fifth fastest out of 18 for Joe Nemechek, the man who, as we were just talking about, dominated the race weekend here at Kansas Speedway 1 year ago. A pole, a race win on Saturday, a race win on Sunday. He'd love to do that again. Back at Kansas Speedway in the NASCAR Busch Series, championship leader has just taken the green flag for his two laps of qualifying. It's Martin Truex Jr.
But he was the fastest man in practice at a 30.08, so that would definitely put him up on the Busch pole right now if he can get back to that speed he ran in practice.
Just remember, guys, he hasn't had the opportunity to be on the racetrack like a lot of these guys that have gone out in front of him. But right now, the car's looking really good as he brings it back to the start-finish line. He's trying to get all he can get right then and there.
Yeah, he wasn't running for that second lap, was he?
A one and done, as they say. One and done, it looked like.
He didn't get back to what he ran in practice, but he definitely was fast enough. He goes to the top of the charts, 30-17. Almost 179 miles per hour average.
And he's still digging, guys. Normally, when you see him go across the apron like that, they're kind of indicating that we're not going to make another lap, but he just kept right on digging.
See if he can get some more.
Wow. just the flying.
He didn't slow down much. 30-21. The qualifying for this team been so solid, not including this qualifying run, which you would assume will end up being there. 14 top five starts, 23 top 10 starts.
And the new leader on the day, Martin Truex Jr., 19 of 54 cars have gone. Bob?
Reed Sorensen in the middle of a points battle for Rookie of the Year and in the top five sitting inside his car, but he's been watching all these veterans go out on the racetrack as far as the Cup guys. You learned anything?
I learned I need to pick up 0.2 for my qualifying lap, but I've been watching Cup practice all day today and listening in, and I think our car's going to be pretty good for the race. Kind of questionable here in qualifying, but I've had races where I haven't qualified too well and raced really good, so I'll be happy to start in the top 10. That'll be really good, and I think we'll be one of the cars to beat come Saturday.
Reed Sorensen, like Mark Martin, one of the guys with a race set up under his car, but I got a question for you guys. Even if you look at Martin Truex Jr.'s run,
he was about a tenth slower than he was in the final practice this morning. Why are the speeds slowing down just a tad?
Well, about temperature.
Yeah, the track temperature, I think, has definitely come up just a little bit since these guys practiced, because they practiced pretty early this morning. And even though the ambient temperature is still pretty cool, the track temperature with the sun on it has come up, not as much grip.
Not to mention a lot more rubber.
We'll be interesting to see if that track temperature drops. You see some of the shadows from the grandstand now as the sun angles over a little bit, maybe behind the wall, turns one and two, get into the shade before the end of this qualifying.
Well, I think you heard Greg Biffle talk about that in his interview, that he maybe didn't have the optimum qualifying draw. I think he would have liked to win a little bit later in the session.
Well, I'll tell you this much right now. If I'm Kyle Busch, who's going out 48th, I'm looking at that sun and all this shadow getting ready to creep on this racetrack, thinking about, may be pretty good by the time I get there.
Not to mention John Wood, who was pretty quick in both practice sessions.
Derek Cope, 20th fastest out of 20 at a 31.54. One of the go-or-go-home cars, and it is going to be a tough road for Derek here for the rest of this qualifying session. Mark Martin coming up. Don't go away. Green flag for Bobby Labonte as we continue with Busch Pole qualifying from the Kansas Speedway. The former NASCAR Nextel Cup Series champion who stayed away from running these Busch Series races for a few years. Now back in the saddle for 2005 on a limited schedule.
But I'm going to tell you, this could be the salvation to sanity for Bobby Labonte this year, because even though he's not had the dream season with his Nextel Cup car, he's made five starts this year in this Busch Series car, four top 10 finishes. So at least it gives him some confidence. I know I can still do this.
Yeah. And the same thing with the Craftsman Truck Series races he's been running too.
And I believe he's got a win in that series.
Martinsville.
12th fastest on the first lap for Bobby, 30.726. Looking for a little more. I believe he was a bit faster than that in practice earlier today.
Yeah, he was eighth quickest at a 30.32, so right now he's about 0.4 off. Now, he plans on running two more races at Texas and Phoenix in this car, and he picks it up quite a bit by 0.2, so he goes to seventh quickest.
Very nice. 30.517 for Bobby Labonte. Well, Martin Truex Jr. now fastest in qualifying, and he's with Dave.
Yeah, and he's trying to make Kansas Speedway Martinsville. What about not backing up the time or improving on it here? Just cold temperatures, Martin?
Yeah, I'm not sure. I didn't quite have the grip I had. We scuffed our tires, and we ran our fast lap in practice on two lap scuffs, and I went out to scuff and somebody crashed, so I got one lap on them. Then I went out again and put one more lap, so it was a little bit different. Not sure if that had anything to do with it, but it was a good run. Car was good. It just didn't quite have the grip it had earlier, so hopefully it stands to hold up. We haven't had many poles this year. It'd be nice to get another one here.
Yeah, it's been a whole seven races since you've had one. It's like a drought, right?
I think we only won all year. So I mean,
did you start first at Gateway, or was that on points?
That was first. Yeah, that was our only pole. So it's been a while. We've been second a bunch of times. Hopefully we get one today.
All right, he'll wait and see, guys.
J.J. Haley. Hopping, skipping, and jumping all the way. That was the triple jump in turn one.
See right there, he bounced his way down there through one and two.
And Jeff, even though this track is fairly smooth, these guys are getting very aggressive with the shot.
Whoa, hang on there, JJ.
And all it takes is one bump to upset the race car, and I think that's what's going on with a lot of cars in turn two and in turn four.
Definitely with this car here now. You've seen a lot of them go down in the turns and bounce around a little bit, but he has had his hands full, and through three and four, he's lucky to get that car back underneath and be able to bring it back to the start-finish line. Good enough to qualify 16th on that lap.
But boy, he's lost 3/4 of a second from what he ran in practice.
But my friend, that's better than losing a race car.
You got it. You got it. Because this is a brand new race car.
There
he's
goes
still
again.
Fighting it.
Yeah. Well, bring it back in one piece. You're in the field. Go race on Saturday. Of course, now in an impound race, that'll leave you scratching your head when you walk back to that truck after when your car was wiggling around and hopping like that on your qualifying lap, huh?
But, Alan, you know, the good thing about it, this weekend, talking to Joe Bilish, the director of the Busch Series, he told me that this week they're going to allow the guys to make some adjustments in the front as well as in the back of the car. They have been able to make shock adjustments and around a wedge and track bar adjustments. But this time they're going to actually make some adjustments in the front of the car, which is a little bit different than what they've been doing.
Now, adjustments to the wedge bolts.
Wedge
they can't
bolts,
change
yes.
spring or anything. They've been able to do 1.5 and 1.5 one and a half on each rear. Now they can do an additional one and one either in or out on each front, so they can adjust, you know, a total of five rounds of wedge in, wedge out.
And Larry, you know, that can be huge right there as we take a look at a guy who's been very busy here lately, the Cat in the Hat, Jack Roush. He's out here with Mark Martin, watching him make his qualifying run in the number nine car.
Well, he said, no, I don't have a chance. Of course, you wouldn't expect Mark Martin to say, oh, yeah, we can go out and win the pole.
Seems like to me that's what he said in an interview before he went out and qualified at Richmond last month when he sat on the pole.
I was going to say, how did that turn out?
Pretty good.
Okay. Well, time to beat's 30.178. Martin Truex Jr. did that a little bit ago.
It looked pretty smooth through three and four, guys. That car definitely was not bouncing around like a lot of the cars.
Not yet. Needs to gain a little bit more. Fifth fastest for Mark on his first lap, 30.418.
And that's exactly what he ran in this morning's practice early on, so it'd be interesting if he can pick up just a little bit.
I got tickered at Pat Tryson, who's actually looking after this car as well as the Nextel Cup car. He said, guess what? Mark let us bring a brand-new race car here because he has six starts in previous this year, and it's been with the same race car. He was pretty excited about this new race car.
Now just a tick slower on the second lap. So Mark still fifth fastest with a car that he says is optimized for race conditions.
Ready to race.
And you can believe him when he says that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Plenty more to go in Busch Pole qualifying. Stick around. Qualifying from Kansas Speedway on speed, Stacy Compton is on track now. This is the first of his two laps.
Stacy was 26th quickest in practice earlier today. Talked to his crew chief Chris Rice, just could not get this car comfortable. 31 flat on his first lap puts him 16th quickest.
Yeah, to say that 2005 has been difficult for Stacy would be pretty conservative, actually.
Yeah, I mean, they've been finishing races. In fact, they hold the longest streak right now at 24 consecutive races in the Busch Series without a DNF, but they have no top five finishes this year. Their best finish is eighth at Kentucky.
And only have three top tens. They just can't get over the hurdle from 11th place into the top 10 every week. And it's frustrating. Second lap is a little bit faster, down into the 32nd bracket, 30.948 for Stacy Compton. That's 15th. Out of 24. All right, Bob Dillner has something planned for us here.
That's right, and we're going to talk to Clint Boyer, a local hero, second in Busch Series points, but he used to be a modified runner over at Lakeside Speedway, and they're running this weekend, so if you want to head out there, Allen, you can check them out. In fact, he ran in the top 10 last night there, but how about putting this car in the top five here today in qualifying, Clint?
It's very important. You know, we have a really good race car and race trim. It was not bad in qualifying trim. Got messed up there on our second lap and didn't get to run it all the way. So pretty confident in the car. You know, they built me a brand new race car to come here. We put a good test under us here a week ago, and I'm just really excited about coming back here and racing in front of the hometown crowd. You know, Kansas Speedway is a special place for me, and hoping to have a lot of fun here tomorrow.
Well, good luck to Clint this weekend. Want to follow me over here, and I need to get to the asphalt portion of pit road here and off of the cement, because we've been talking about that track temperature all morning long here and in qualifying. Well, this is the gun that the 67 team uses, and you can see 67 degrees on there from this morning. That was their final run of the final practice. Now, if we measure the track temperature here, right now, as you guys predicted, it has gone up to 72, 74, now 76 degrees. So how much of a change is it from 67 to the mid-70s, boys?
That's quite a bit. I mean, I know it does not sound like a lot, but it's just it loses grip. The car just does not grip, and I think that's the reason we've seen a lot of cars like Martin Truex Jr. slow down from what he ran in practice.
But anytime you can you know, cool that racetrack off, you know, you would definitely want to, you know, take advantage of that grip that's available. And that's, I think, again, that's where temperature comes into play. As we watch Reed Sorensen right to complete his second lap, winds up 13th quickest in the 41 car.
Yep, did not find those 2/10 he said he was going to need.
Coming into Kansas, Brian Patty on his suspension. He's halfway. He has three more races, so he will be back for the final three events starting at Texas after the suspension at Bristol Motor Speedway, back in the Busch Series race there in August for what they felt like was tampering with the tires.
Reed third in the championship and doesn't get talked about a lot because he's 258 points out of the lead, but nothing saying that you have one bad race for both Truex and Boyer that he couldn't be back in the thick of things.
You just need to, I guess you might say, he needs that door to be cracked open. But I still believe, Larry, that the fact he's not had Brian there, you know, working with him as closely as he would normally have him, I think that's affected this team. Even though Jimmy Elledge and everybody at Ganassi Racing have been working very closely, you know, trying to help him stay up there in that point and keep him up as far as rookie of the year is concerned, that comfort level I don't think is there.
Well, Brian Patty is a good head coach, good leader, as we watch Jason Keller start his qualifying run. But you talk about Reed Sorensen and Carl Edwards. The real battle is between those two guys for Rookie of the Year. There's only 9 points separating those two with six races to go.
Yep. Jason Keller, first lap, 15th out of 27. I guess we'll start counting the one car that will not be able to start his qualifying run here. Chris Horn had a crash this morning and will not start in qualifying. So we'll say 27 of 54 have gone now.
Yeah, Chris Horn had a little bit of issue just right off the truck, had an oil line come loose, and then later on got into the wall. And I want to go back and say one thing, though, about Reed Sorensen. I've been noticing this young man because he knows he's getting ready to make the step up next year to Nextel Cup. He's been down there on top of that truck with Jimmy Elledge, with Tony Glover, watching and listening to what goes on during these practices so he can learn from these experienced veterans right there that he's going to be racing with next year.
A little bit slower on lap two for Jason Keller, leaves him 15th out of 27, and leaves us about midway through this Busch Bowl qualifying session from Kansas Speedway. Martin Truex Jr. leads the championship, and he leads qualifying this afternoon, too. Kansas Speedway, it's Busch Pole qualifying on speed. This is Chad Blunt in car number two on the day.
This is a backup car. Had a crash in practice fairly late in that final practice session.
Yeah. Chad's been running the ARCA season through July.
Whoa, boys, hang on. I saw the front end on that car there. It just turned loose all of a sudden, Larry, and up the racetrack he went.
It's a hard lick right there.
Flattens the right side of the car once again. In car number 70, the Washington, Indiana driver.
Driving it in.
Man, this is a lot of damage to that right front. The right front's not even rolling. It's been in so bad.
This is a go-or-go-home car, so we know this will be one of the cars that will not make the show.
I tell you what, the damage on that car looks remarkably like the damage on the other car from the wreck this morning. So.
You're carrying so much speed through these corners. I mean, I know it's a mile and a half racetrack, but you heard Greg Biffle talk. You're trying to run around here almost wide open.
That's weird.
Like I said, all of a sudden, it looked like the front end just lost grip, and it went up the racetrack, and he couldn't get it to turn.
See if we can look at a little different angle. The car never really turned.
No.
Yeah, you know, a lot of times if they just get loose, you'll see the car walk up the racetrack. This car just never really turned, Jeff.
Never turned.
I was trying to watch the front end to see if the right front corner dropped,
too, yeah.
like if a tire went down on him or something, but it's just so hard to say. Well,
see Chad taking the helmet off inside the race car, so that's a good sign.
But the red flag is out, and Chad Blunt will not be in Saturday's field for the United Way 300.
We need to mention of the go-or-go-homers that have qualified, Mark Martin, Bobby Labonte, and Joe Nemechek, who are all in the top eight. They are locked into the show now.
They'll go out and check the track for debris and so on and get Chad Blunt's car towed away. You see Chad out of the car while we wait. Let's, what?
I was going to say, I know a perfect way to pass time during a red flag.
Do you? What would that be?
Interview Kenny Wallace. You don't even
That's
have to interview
idea.
Him, guys. You could just give the microphone to him, and he's a show unto himself. Kenny Wallace, 28th quick this morning, so I'll just hand you the microphone, and you can talk for a while.
Well, first of all, we looked at my average. Everywhere we've been where there's been, like, you know, a big race, like California, Charlotte, You know, where all the cup teams are here, we average anywhere from 20 to 25th when we qualify. I'm known to qualify a lot better. So we don't know what's going on. You know, we'd like to qualify better, but what's got us concerned right now is we're not that good. We don't have much speed either. So Wes, my crew chief of the AutoZone Ford, where you can buy great parts. I'm a guy, I sound like Michael Waltrip. But anyway, he's done some work on it. He's changed some balance on the car with some nose weight. And man, we just want to get it better. We tested up here and we still can't get the car, you know, the speed. It's handling good. They're just walking the dog on me. So we're just trying hard, but we'll just see what happens.
See what happens. That wasn't too bad. That was only about a minute and a half from Kenny Wallace. But he's a happy guy, not just because he's racing here in the Busch Series, but also because his St. Louis Cardinals are doing very well in the Major League Baseball playoffs right now. We'll be back at Kansas with more of Busch qualifying in a moment.
It is Busch pole qualifying about set to resume after the red flag delay for the Chad Blunt crash over in turns 3 and 4. Chad, you saw climb from the car okay, but a few minutes delay here for cleanup. And now we get set to resume. Ashton Lewis Jr. will be the next driver.
Larry, I don't know about you, but whenever you have to go out right after a crash like that, I know as a crew chief, a lot of times you have to do a pretty good sell job to your driver to let him know that racetrack is in good shape. And he's right.
Well, I think qualifying here puts a driver on nerve end anyhow, because you're trying to run so fast. I think just the anticipation, especially as he drives down through this corner right here for the first time where Chad Blunt crashed, even though it's coming to take the green. But if your fast lap is going to come on lap one, getting through 3 and 4, coming to take the green is where a lot of that speed is built up.
Just like the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series, the top 10 in the NASCAR Busch Series at the end of the year get on stage at the awards banquet. Ashton's kind of locked in a tight fight for that 10th spot. Fell out of it at Bristol after being in it for most of the year. And he's 85 points behind 10th place now as we close in on the end of the year.
And if I'm not mistaken, that's his teammate he keeps battling with, Jason Keller.
Yeah.
They've been back and forth between 10th and 11th. Ashton had a great run here a year ago, finished 4th. See what he can do on his first lap. 31-13. It puts him 21st quickest.
Yep. And this racetrack for Ashton has been pretty good.
Yeah, he has slowed down about 0.3 from what he ran earlier. He ran a 30.87.
Now, Larry, did you notice how his car almost did the same move?
Sounds like he has a reason for his. He's already right. Told us, just real loose. Again, they tape these noses up solid, pins that nose, makes the car loose. He picks up about a 10th, picks up one position on lap two.
So 20th out of 30 for Ashton Lewis Jr. And he'll be a mid-pack at best for the green flag on Saturday.
But again, watching him go through that turn, it made me think that almost that Chad Blunt type of move as he went into turn three. The front end kind of did almost a D-Di-Do and it's going to go up the racetrack, but he was able to save it.
All right, here's the hometown hero. For the fans here in Kansas, Clint Bowyer from Emporia. Not all that far away. Of course, Clint making his name in racing on the local tracks around here, became a NASCAR regional champion in weekly competition, caught the eye of Richard Childress.
As a matter of fact, he was up here at the Lakeside Speedway, just about 3 miles up the road here from Kansas Speedway, racing a dirt car last night, or hanging out at the dirt track a little bit. So it's just hard to get that kind of I guess you might say racing roots out of these guys. They keep wanting to go back where they started.
Car looks awfully good. He was 4th quickest in practice, right around the bottom of the racetrack, right around that white line.
His rival for the championship, Martin Truex Jr., has the fast lap so far. How does Clint Bowyer compare? Survey says, okay. Not great. Okay.
8th quickest. But if he can pick up a couple of tenths, which we've seen a lot of these cars do, that put him up there right in the top 5. This is a brand new car, and since he really wanted to shine here at Kansas's home track, they came out here and tested this new car a week or so ago. Had his hands full right there as he went to pick the throttle up in the middle of the corner. You could see the car wiggle, pretty busy inside there.
up to sixth there, Larry. Picks up a little bit there on the second lap.
Got 0.03 of a second quicker on that second lap. So sixth out of 31 for Clint Bowyer. Not all that far behind. He'll be close enough to Truex to see him when the race starts anyway.
And he has finished higher than Martin Truex Jr. in the last four races, from 204 points five races ago to only 26 points out.
Bobby D.
I'm with Kevin Harvick's development driver, Bernie Lamar, but you see right there on his car, it says worm. What's that all about, Bernie?
You'll have to talk to the crew guys about that, you know, but all I got to say is, you know, this Yardman car is running pretty good, and got to thank Kevin DeLander for this opportunity. It should be a lot of fun.
You nervous?
A little bit. You know, the main thing is we'll go out and just, we're in the show, and just go out and have some fun, but the main thing is if John Paul's out there watching, I sure wish you were here, man. I hope you're feeling better, and look forward to seeing you soon, buddy.
Of course, all of us thinking about Delaney's father as Kevin is on his way already back to North Carolina.
All right, Bobby, thanks. Here is Jerry Robertson, another guy made his mark in NASCAR weekly competition. Talked about Clint Bowyer doing that. Jerry Robertson did as well.
Tell you what, he was pretty good in practice earlier today. He's been reeling off some pretty good qualifying runs. He was 13th quickest earlier today. It's going to be a good first lap for Jerry. Mm-hmm. 30-56, 11th quickest on lap one.
Kind of like, all right, crew chief, tell me something. Yeah. Do I need to keep digging? Yeah. I don't think so.
He was in the he was one of the go or go home cars. So to knock that kind of time off, that's big relief there.
It is, and that's why I'm saying I'm surprised to see him keep trying to come back here to the start finish line when you know you're in the show, which is so important to this team. Is just making races and giving him an opportunity to get seat time.
His crew chief,
well,
Joe,
I'll tell
Garoni,
you why they went the second lap.
He's definitely picked up, and he's definitely in now. He's up ninth quickest, and Larry McReynolds, he's bumped his way in.
There you go.
He went from being not locked in on the first lap to being locked in on the second lap.
In.
Very nice. Ninth fastest for Jerry Robertson. Out of 32 drivers here at Kansas Speedway, Carl Edwards coming up. On the clock at Kansas Speedway is Curtis Davis in Busch Pole qualifying. Looking to grab himself a starting spot in Saturday's United Way 300.
Curtis was 46th quickest in practice earlier today, and this is another one of the go or go home cars.
Larry, it'll be real interesting to see whether or not he can pull some more magic out of that hat. Seems like every time he needs to pick it up to get into the show, this young man's been able to do it so far this year.
Compared to some cars, that car looked pretty solid from the middle of turn three and four out.
Yep. It looked good, but it wasn't quite as fast as it looked. 31-29 for Curtis, 27th place out of 33 so far.
Right now, you need to run in the 30-50s, low 30-50s, to lock yourself into the show.
I'm sure he would settle for something in the neighborhood of about a 31 flat right about now. We'd put him in pretty good shape. He can just find a little more speed out of that zero car.
Tell you what, the car that could be in trouble here, as he has been on a couple of other occasions this year, because Curtis has already outran him, is Michael Waltrip in that 99 car, sitting back there 28th quickest right now.
Mm-hmm. A little bit faster on lap two for Curtis, puts him 26th out of 33. And so eliminated from the race, Kevin LePage and Derek Culp. They will not be in the race. They can not make the field on time now. And Chad Blunt and Chris Horn also eliminated. And it puts Tim Sauter on the bubble among the go or go home cars. Well, here's another guy with, I guess you'd call this his home track. He would call it his home track.
Definitely so.
From Springfield, Missouri, Carl Edwards getting ready to go.
Well, you can tell by the local PA announcer here at the track.
Yeah.
Whenever he announced him, a lot of folks here at the grandstand today cheering him on. Again, we watch Jack Roush, affectionately called the Cat in the Hat, stand there on pit road watching Carl Edwards make his qualifying attempt.
Carl was 29th quickest in practice earlier at a 30-81.
Three Craftsman Truck Series starts here previously for Carl, with a win and a second place among his results.
Whoa, we used up all the racetrack coming off of turn two.
Carl spent the week in Columbia, Missouri, in his hometown, before coming on over here to the racetrack.
Got too high down here.
Got a just a little bit high on the exit of turn three and four. First lap, 23rd quickest at a 31.03.
So he did the same thing off of turn two a minute ago also. Carl Lewis trying to kick out from underneath him right there, Larry, off the corner.
Spitting that water already, too.
So right now, he's a couple of tenths off from what he ran in practice earlier. Looked a little better on the exit of turn four that time. Didn't walk as far up the racetrack. Let's see if he can pick it up on lap two. Picks it up quite a bit to a 30.65. That's a good pickup. That's about as much as we've seen.
Yeah. Yep, 4/10 of a second.
And I think it was all on the exit of turn four.
16th right now for Carl Edwards out of 34. And we check with Bobby Dean.
A new name on top of the 34 this week. Todd Bodine is in. Randy LaJoie out at least for now. Second time Todd is behind the wheel of the 34 this year. What is this all about, Todd?
Well, the main thing is, you know, we've lost our general as a sponsor. They're going to another team, and we're looking for sponsorship. So, you know, we had nothing to lose. We're kind of struggling a little bit with the team, and it put somebody else different in to kind of get a direction and see where we need to improve, what things we need to do to make the team better and go faster. And, you know, Randy's done a great job for us all year, and he's a good friend of mine, and he's here helping and consulting and trying to help the team. And we're just trying to get better and, you know, another outlook, another perspective on the situation. Hopefully it'll lead to something better and get this CC Kelly team back to the front.
Right now the plan is for Todd to be in the car here at Kansas and next week at Charlotte, and then they will evaluate the situation.
I do know that Randy will race that car at Memphis in a couple of weeks when Todd will be in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series race at Martinsville.
Yep. David Stremme, eighth-place driver in the NASCAR Busch Series Championship, had a great run here at Kansas a year ago. Started ninth, finished third.
You know, we don't want to leave this hanging in the air, so as David Stremme completes his second lap, I think Dave Burns can tell us what happened to Chad Blunt, the 70 car, down there in turn three and four. How about it, Dave?
Yeah, Larry, that sure had the look of a something broke wreck, didn't it?
Yes, it did. The car just never turned. It didn't wiggle. It just went straight.
Yep, we checked with their crew, and they very simply said sway bar bolt cut right front.
So, and that could be the product of the hurry-up mode with a backup car.
Yep.
Thank you, Dave.
20th for David Stremme at a 30.74, the first of his two laps. And so David will come from midfield at the green flag tomorrow, looking to duplicate his fine run. And, of course, David with a couple more Nextel Cup starts this year before moving into the Ganassi 40 car for next year. How about the big field here at Kansas?
That's something Larry and I were talking about early on today when we got together. It's 54 cars. I think that's pretty impressive this late in the season to see this many cars showing up at a racetrack.
And, you know, I went and talked to Joe Ballish, competition director for the Busch Series, and as a whole, for whatever reason, we always have had a high car count here for the Busch Series race. We had 54 a year ago.
You know, you get, as we watch Michelle Jourdain Jr. take the green flag, this, by the way, a backup car. He had a crash in practice. You get that point late in the season. The weekly racing is done for most people. So guys that are looking to move up and see if they can crack that next level, get a car together, come out. We see some of those guys out here at the Kansas. And then you get the Nextel Cup guys that are either working on 06 or working on the Chase, get a car together, working out, you know. So there's a lot of reasons for people to bring a car out, not just the guys that have been running all season.
Yeah, it's the same as the Nextel Cup. You have all these different agendas, just like you heard Todd Bodine. They're evaluating their race team right now.
Yeah.
But the biggest goal they've got to accomplish is find a sponsorship for that 34 car for next year.
One and done for Michelle Jourdain Jr. It is a pretty decent lap for backup car that he didn't get any practice on.
I was going to say, he crashed with about 35 or 40 seconds to go in that final practice session. That is a good lap for Michelle.
30.83 and a 22nd out of 36. And a nice job.
Very nice.
Aaron Fike will be the next car.
We'll give him an attaboy.
Give that whole team an attaboy for getting it ready, because you know what a challenge it can be. We've already heard about the Chad Blunt situation with the sway bar boat.
Yeah, that could be probably the most impressive part of the whole situation right there, is what this team had to do in a short period of time, getting the car prepared, as it made a, you know, very solid effort right there from Michelle Jourdain.
Another go or go home car now, heading for the green flag. This is Aaron Fike. Kerr Bagajanian 43.
has split his time between this car this year and sharing that 66 car from Bruco Racing with Greg Biffle. Wiggle, wiggle.
Say hang on there, brother.
Yeah.
He was 43rd quickest in practice at a 31.10 earlier today. And we need to mention that we can add Bobby Labonte and Matt Kenseth to the cars that are locked into the show now.
By the way, while we watch Fike, I don't think I mentioned during our last break, Brent Sherman made his qualifying lap at a 30.72. He's 18th right now out of 37.
31.22 for Aaron Fike. That puts him 28th quickest right now. And we need to make note, we were talking about it a while ago, Michael Waltrip in the 99 will not race in this 300-miler tomorrow.
By that lap, Michael is bumped out of the show.
I think Aaron's going to probably need to pick it up a little bit to feel safe about being in this show. And he picks it up to a 30.99, pretty good pickup. So he has a little bit of a cushion right now.
Yeah, it didn't. It moved him up to 25th place in the overall rankings, but it didn't move him up anywhere in the go-or-go-home ranking.
And that's what's important.
Yeah. So we'll see for Aaron Fike as we run out to Busch Pole qualifying from here at Kansas Speedway. Kenny Wallace among those coming up. We come back. Kenny Wallace on the clock as we come back to Kansas Speedway for NASCAR Busch Series qualifying.
Kenny was 28th quickest in practice. Another one of those guys sitting good in the points, sitting six, but desperately trying to get to victory lane in these final six races.
Yeah, very tight fight for fifth, Kenny is in. And he runs a 30.81, 21st.
And what did he say beforehand as we interviewed him earlier? Somewhere between 20th and 25th is what they've been qualifying. So right now he's 21st. He needs to pick it up just a little bit if he kind of break out of that little slump he's in.
I'm glad you picked that up on that interview. I'm not sure what I picked up on it.
You got to understand, I worked with Kenny for a while as a driver crew chief combination back in the mid-90s. So I got to be a pretty good interpreter.
Okay, I got you.
Kenny would kind of be like, you know, like you instruct these drivers sometimes, you got to slow down and sort through the information, and then you can go faster.
There you go.
I've got one question for you right there, okay?
Yeah.
You ever tried that? Have you ever tried to get a driver to understand that?
No.
Okay.
21st for Kenny Wallace, and... I know. Well, he'd like better than that. Bob?
We've been looking for Kyle Busch for quite some time. In fact, he got so desperate down here that the boys told me if he doesn't get down here quick, you jump in the car. And I think you can do a little bit better behind the wheel of this number five car than me.
I doubt it very seriously that they told you to get in the car. I
heard they did. Howard Shipwash said, get behind the seat. You're about as tall as it.
Well, I heard you're pretty good on the dirt, though.
So-so.
Okay, all right. Well, Lowe Chevrolet is pretty good this weekend. You know, we practiced earlier today, of course, and we were working a lot on race trim, as everybody was, but there's a bunch of things that we tried and kind of went through with shocks and springs and different stuff like that to see if we could help it out to get any more speed out of it, and we never really found any speed. We got the car where it was more comfortable and stuff like that, but just weren't able to find the Truex speed out there, so I'm hoping that we can qualify somewhere within a top 10 here today and, you know, just have a good, strong showing tomorrow here in Kansas.
And, Alan, a very well-balanced car will be very important in tomorrow's race.
Yes, sir. 300 miles here. It's a long race. It takes some doing. Here's Dave Blaney getting a good grind on that left front fender valance there, just in front of the left front tire on his first lap.
Ran fast up on that first lap, though, Alan, to move himself right up into the field, makes him 24th quickest, but more importantly, he's now locked in.
Yep, 30.85 for Dave. Bumps Mark Green out of the race. It's Curtis Davis down on the bubble of the go-or-go-home cars.
Need to mention Michelle Jourdain has been locked into the show as well in that 15 backup car.
Yeah, very nice. Second lap for Dave Blaney. A tick faster moves him up to 22nd place. 30.826 seconds. So 22nd out of 40 for Dave Blaney. Very good. Jason Leffler coming up. Kyle Busch still to run. Todd Bodine as well. It's Busch Pole qualifying from Kansas Speedway on speed. Back at Kansas Speedway with Jason Leffler on the clock in Busch Pole qualifying, trying to race his way into the field for Saturday's United Way 300. While we were away in the break, Jamie Mosley ran unsuccessful at his qualifying attempt.
Tell you what, guys, now Jason was sixth quickest in practice, and right now the whole front straightaway, turn one and the middle of one and two, is in shade, so we know it's cooling down, getting a little bit of grip. Let's see what Jason can do on his first lap.
Good lap.
30.62 puts him 16th quickest. He ran a 30.30 in practice earlier this morning.
Saw the left front tire rubbing just a little bit right there in the middle of one and two.
Here's a team and driver combination that have been getting better and better and better as they've gotten together here. Seventh, fifth, and third, their last three finishes. And starting to come together. Of course, it's been a rough season for this race team.
Yes, it has, very much. So it's good to see them up there running front. Boy, does he ever pick it up.
Three tenths.
He goes to fourth quickest in this 32 car. Great run for this team.
But Alan, as you were pointing out, I mean, this is what Jason's needed, and this is what that 32 crew have needed. They know they've had a fast race car all year long. They just needed somebody in there that could be consistent, and he's brought that to them.
And we were talking about it earlier, where a racetrack just seems to suit a driver's style. Remember, Jason Leffler sat on the pole for the inaugural Nextel Cup race here back in 2001, driving for Chip Ganassi.
So good for Jason, good for Braun Racing, and a good starting spot for tomorrow's race at fourth fastest at a 30.326. Very nice. Jeff Fuller also ran while we were away in that last break, by the way. Jeff at a 31.017, 29th fastest. And he is second as far as the cars on the bubble for making or not making this race. Here's Kim Crosby. Go or go home car.
And not very fast in practice earlier today. 53rd quickest out of the 54 cars. So she's really going to have to step it up in this qualifying run if she'd like to run tomorrow.
Going to make the field for her first race here at Kansas Speedway.
Got a chance to talk to her just a little bit this morning. And she had pretty much a long face on when I was talking to her. And she said, right now, we just don't have the horsepower we need. Expect them to make an engine change this upcoming week at Lowe's Motor Speedway. And they tested there, and they felt like that they had been able to get the car working better for her. And they felt like with an extra horsepower, they'd be able to run a little bit quicker. And I know she's going to be disappointed with that effort, but they're up here still gamely trying to make these races.
The way you started off saying that, and you said you were talking to her and she had a long face, I, you know, wasn't sure where you were going with that.
No, she just really felt like, you know, she was doing all she could, and she just, you know, was kind of disappointed because, I mean, she really wants to race. I mean, you can see it and hear it in her voice that she's serious about what she's wanting to do here. And frustration was really kind of like sitting in, because she's out there driving as hard as she can, and she needs all the help she can get as far as the horsepower, the car to work like it needs to give her the experience that she needs to be able to be competitive.
Not going to make the race for tomorrow. 41st out of 43 for Kim Crosby. And we check downstairs with Bob.
Third in the final practice was John Wood. Do you have enough in this car here to beat that A car?
I'm not sure. The track looks like it's a little bit slower than it was earlier whenever we were out. He slowed down a little, but not quite as much as everyone else has. So just hopefully we can secure a top 10 starting spot. That'll be good enough. I don't think there's going to be a lot of passing done here tomorrow. Just going to be a lot of follow the leader, so to speak. On a lighter note, your jacket looks good.
Thanks so much. My small jacket, yes. John Wood, the 2003 Kressman Truck winner here at Kansas.
Here's Bernie Lamar, 25-year-old, originally from Sacramento. Said he's been running everything they can get their hands on to run this year. Southwest Series, NASCAR West Series, Kressman Truck Race at Vegas a couple weeks ago, the ARCA race at Talladega last week.
Been awfully busy. He was actually pretty good in practice earlier. 20th quickest in the car. Looked decent, especially coming through turn three and four where so many people have had trouble. I'll say it's a good lap. Sixth quickest for Bernie on that first lap.
Hang on there, Bernie. It's a little bit loose right in the middle of that corner, but he's not lifting.
Make the call.
Bring it to the house, baby. You're in the show. Solid run. One and done is what I've been doing if I was his crew chief.
He actually ran identical time to Mark Martin in the 9 car, but the tiebreaker is the car that's highest in the owner points. Of course, the 33 runs all the races. The 9 runs a limited schedule.
That's the Kevin Harvick Incorporated Racing Team. Second lap, a little bit slower for Bernie Lamar, but he will make his NASCAR Busch Series debut on Saturday.
And I think it's pretty easy to see why Kevin Harvick is so high on this young man.
Martin Truex Jr. still leading Busch Pole qualifying here at Kansas Speedway. Got 10 cars to go, and anyone from Truex from the top spot. It's Busch Pole qualifying at the Kansas Speedway. On speed, you're looking at TJ Bell take the white flag, completing the first of his two qualifying laps. Youngster from Reno, Nevada, not too good. 43rd right now at a 31.73. Carlos Contreras ran while we were in the break with a very nice lap.
Very good lap. Up to 21st quickest for Carlos in the number 40 car.
Talked to Ricky Pearson, the crew chief on this car for TJ Bell, and he said that you know, TJ had a lot of good feedback, had a good feel for the race car, but he just needed to, you know, get more of an opportunity to see these racetracks. I mean, a lot of times it's his first opportunity to see a place like Kansas. And Larry, you know yourself, the speed and that you carry around this racetrack can really challenge a young driver when he doesn't have a lot of experience.
Yeah, I mean, I think the first time that he had seen this track was when they rolled in here yesterday for inspection, but he will be in the show, even though he's 39th quickest right now.
Yeah, Heathcliff is going to have to scratch and claw his way up from the back of the field.
Has work to do.
Can I get a drum roll, please?
But I'm pumped.
Well, here comes Kyle Busch. And will this be a challenge to Martin Truex's hold on the top spot?
He didn't really show it in practice. At a 30.55, he was 21st quickest, so he'd have to pick up quite a bit from what he ran in practice. We've seen some cars pick up, but not a lot of cars here late in this session.
I think I was surprised about that. Thought maybe when the racetrack got cooled off that these guys would go a little bit quicker.
But Jeff, have you not seen this? We've already talked about how cold it is here.
Mm-hmm.
That somewhere it gets so cold you lose grip as well.
It goes the other way just because of the fact you can't get enough heat build up in the tires to really make them work like you need to. But when it comes to Kyle Busch, my friend, you know that if his car has got the speed in it, he's going to be going for it.
Been kind of surprised at the results they've had this year in this car. Kyle has had 11 starts in this car and has had one top 10 finish.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course, he won that
race.
He won
it. Lowe's Motor Speedway, and that's not a great first lap, 31.01. As he's running his second lap, we need to congratulate his crew chief, Chad Walter, and his wife, Sherry. You talk about a new addition to the family. How about Jackson Grant Walter that weighed in at 10 pounds, 15 ounces?
Wow.
Walking and talking.
Yes, sir.
Second lap a little bit better for Kyle at a 30.815. Bumps him up to 25th starting spot. Kyle in the race for tomorrow. And we check with Dave. I thought he'd gone home.
You know, I was just thinking, Alan, I should start with that. I haven't been on in so many minutes here. No, we've actually caught up with Jason Leffler, who didn't best his practice time, but it was still a pretty good lap. Is it just the cool track? Is the track too cold?
I don't know. I can't put my finger on it. The car's a little free. It seemed like the track lost a little bit of grip, but Convoy Hope Chevrolet is really good. Got to thank all the guys from Brown Racing, Todd Losey. They're all doing a great job, and have a great race car for tomorrow, so looking forward to it.
Race trim was pretty good?
Oh, yeah, it was really good. And we're actually pretty excited about that qualifying run because this car at Chicago didn't qualify very well at all, but in a race it was really fast. So track position is going to be pretty important, and we have that right now.
Thanks, Jason. Dave Burns reporting still from the garage area, waiting for someone to best that time on the top of the charts. I don't know if it's going to happen, guys.
Yeah, well, I don't know.
We have one strong possibility. Just remember John Wood. They tested out here in the 47 car, and he was fast in both practice sessions.
And he's next. First year's Todd Bodine. CC Kelly Racing. You heard the story from Todd before. It's sponsor on this team going elsewhere for next year, and the team just looking to sort through their performance and see if they can pick it up a little bit here at the end of 05 and establish themselves as sponsor worthy for 06.
Well, his first lap, he's 25th quickest right now. Alan, see if he can pick up on that just a little bit more on the second lap. He'd pick up another 10th. He could move on up the charts pretty well.
But he is definitely one of the cars of late that the first one to pick up from what he ran in practice earlier by a couple of tenths.
It's been on a pretty good roll in the Craftsman Truck Series, Todd. A couple of wins and really got that program picked up.
Boy, that was a great race at Las Vegas a couple of weeks ago between him and Ted Musgrave.
Yeah. Second lap for Todd, a little bit faster.
About 0.06 of a second quicker. Puts him in 20th spot for tomorrow's race, 30.720.
Tell you what, for a mile and a half racetrack, this is actually, especially when you look there between about 5th and, say, 25th, it's really a pretty tight qualifying session. We've got a lot of cars in the 50s, a lot of cars in the 60s, and a ton of cars in the 70s.
Like you said right there a minute ago, Todd Bodine picks up about 0.06 of a second and moves up 5 spots.
All right, here comes John Wood. Very fast in practice. Will it be fast enough?
He was the fastest in the first practice earlier this morning and then third quickest in the final practice several hours ago. Now, his time was a 30.22, so if he could pick it up just a little over a half a tenth from that, he could knock Martin Truex Jr. in the 8 car off of the Busch pole right now.
30.178, time to beat. John Wood with a Craftsman Truck Series win here.
And this was a team, Allen, in the beginning of the season, showed so much spark. They finished second at Talladega. Then they somewhat just kind of hit the wall. They were having freak things happen. Like, I think there was a race where the throttle linkage broke.
Hang on to your hats, boys.
30.19, wow. Second quickest for John. If he can just pick it up 0.02 of a second, he could knock Truex off the pole right now. We've seen cars definitely pick that much up on lap two.
Great first lap, though.
Well, let's see.
On the racetrack, here digging.
Can he do it? Needs a couple hundredths of a second to squeeze his way past Martin Truex Jr. for the pole. Was it good enough?
No.
No, slowed down just a little bit.
Now you didn't get him, buddy. Good job, though. 30.19.
But that has to be a great confidence booster for John Wood, Jay Guy, the crew chief, and that whole number 47 team.
This program, as well as the Wood Brothers Nextel Cup program, will benefit from the partnership that they announced, what, a month and a half, two months ago, between Tad Geschichter, the owner of this Busch Series team, and the Wood Brothers. Tad is, he knows marketing. He knows how to find sponsors. He knows how to help the commercial side of the team. And the Wood Brothers, with all their investing in engineering and building up their resources, that will help the performance of this team on the competition side in the NASCAR Busch Series.
A little different alliance than what we've seen. We've seen Cup cars join Cup cars, Busch join Busch, but this is a Cup and a Busch car joining forces.
It really is, and I think the other thing here, guys, that maybe we're not really touching on is that, yeah, those guys will make a great partner, but for this young driver to feel like his family as well as this owner are willing to do this for him, to keep him involved in not only the Busch side of it, but the Cup side of it, I think as a confidence booster that John Wood is going to benefit from.
John second fastest now, just a few cars left to go. Here's David Green, 5 cars to go specifically. David, former winner here at Kansas a couple of years ago.
Of course, the winner at Pikes Peak back in July, and just this past week, we found out just how significant that win really was. The final Busch Series race at Pikes Peak, it was sold this past week and a half ago, and the Busch race will move to Martinsville, Virginia next year.
That's a pretty significant lap there. Very nice, 6th fastest for David.
30.37, good lap. That's a couple of tenths faster than what he ran in practice.
Yeah, he was 19th in practice earlier. Be good to see after that win at Pikes Peak, they had a couple of more top 10 finishes and then just kind of have slipped back into the 20s for a lot of these races here lately and haven't been able to keep that consistency up. So it'd be nice to see David have another solid run here at Kansas.
At least he's still hanging in the top 10 in points, sitting there 9th right now.
Second lap a little slower, 6th for David Green. And now 4 cars to go in Busch pole qualifying here at the Kansas Speedway. John Woods, 2nd fastest. Back at Kansas Speedway, down to the final couple of cars in Busch pole qualifying. Steve Grissom is on the clock now, his first lap, 49th fastest.
And Steve was only 51st quickest in practice, but since Bobby Labonte, the other previous champion in the Busch Series, is locked in the show, we do know that Steve Grissom in the 49 car will use the championship provisional unless he picks up a significant amount on this second lap.
Second lap actually a little bit slower, Larry. So Steve Grissom at 32.021, not fast enough to qualify on time, but should be in the show on that champion's provisional. Dave Burns is with the 2nd fastest driver.
He is well into the show, and we've been talking just a little bit about how frustrating that is. Now that you know a little bit about the lap, John, what'd your crew chief tell you?
Well,
it wasn't your crew chief. It was part of your team.
Yeah, I mean, it's to the point, like I was telling you, at Kentucky we qualified second, and I said, you know what, I didn't have a pole position car. And it's just frustrating to know that I had a little more in me and I was just being conservative. But to improve on perfection is something that a lot of racers want to do, and I think perfect is the way we had it in practice, and we went faster. So hopefully I can back that up tomorrow, and we can race up front.
You'll start on the outside of the front row, it appears, guys.
Yep, very nice job by John. Here's Kevin Hamlin on the clock now. I'll tell you that while we were away in the break, Tony Raines ran the 36th fastest lap in a second Kevin Harvick Incorporated entry. It was good enough to lock Tony into the race and bump Jorge Getters from the field for tomorrow's United Way 300.
Kevin Hamlin in the four car was 40th quickest in practice. Kevin making his first start here at Kansas. Been in this car now for about 2.5 months. His first start was at Pikes Peak back in July.
Former NASCAR Northwest Series champion.
Probably not the lap he was looking for.
No. No, sir. 41st fastest, 31:26. Kevin is guaranteed a spot in the race. So not the end of the world, but it's also not how you want to get in either.
And of course, Kevin is part of the driver development program for Ganassi. In fact, he was over in Nashville doing some testing for Ganassi earlier in the week.
Chase head all the way down onto the apron. Picks up some time on the second lap. 39th fastest for Kevin, 31:15 on lap number two. And so he will be in the field for tomorrow's race, but coming from the back of the pack for his first trip around Kansas Speedway. And another young development driver will be last on the racetrack, and that'll be Joel Kaufman in the Fitz Bradshaw 12, and he will be the final driver to qualify here at Kansas.
Tell you what, he was pretty solid in practice. He was 23rd quickest, but the biggest thing, I walked by and talked to his crew, and they were all smiles, and this team has not had a lot to smile about this year. A lot of different drivers in this race car, a lot of good runs, a lot of tore-up race cars. They were pretty optimistic headed into this qualifying run here for this young man.
19 years old from LaGrange, Indiana. You know, it sounds silly to say, but it's reality anymore. 19 years old, but been racing for 10 years.
And you know, Alan, I was talking to someone the other day. It was not that many years ago. You wouldn't touch a 19-year-old driver for the Busch Series or the Nextel Cup Series. Now that's what everyone's looking for both series.
And, a little wiggle there. Nice catch. But years ago, like when Dale Jarrett was coming up through, you weren't racing at 9 years old in anything. Those kids running quarter midgets at 5 years old, and they do have 10, 15 years experience by the time they're 20 years old.
Tell you what, even with that bobble though, Alan, that's a great lap for him. He's a little quicker than he ran in practice, 13 quickest at a 30:48. And I know people, members of the media and the press, I know that's us too, but I'm talking about the guys in the press room. They want to compare the young guys today with the rookies. Bobby Labonte, Dale Earnhardt, Dale Jarrett, guys you mentioned. I just think you can't compare it because these guys are stepping in top-notch rides now today. Those guys were in upstart teams or teams that they own themselves. So I don't know that it's a good comparison.
I'm trying to compare Hank Aaron to Barry Bonds. Different times. First lap fastest for Joel Kaufman. 13th quickest, Martin Truex Jr. wins the pole. Final results after this.
Back here at Kansas, where Martin Truex Jr. wins his second pole of the year. Just by a little bit, you're taking a look at the Verizon fastest lap for Martin Truex Jr. How about it? By 0.02 of a second, Martin.
Man, that was close. Good lap, though. Car was really good all day long. Got to thank all the guys. They've done a good job. So look forward to tomorrow. Hopefully we can stay up there all day long and have a good day.
Martin Truex Jr., the Busch pole winner here. Trackside is next, live on Speed.